Hey everybody, Tim Allison here, host of the Screw the Naysayers podcast. Get that out, Tim. This episode is part of a new mini-series on Screw the Naysayers, and it's featuring returning guests who focus specifically on providing practical advice and tips to help us navigate, you know, the challenging times that everybody's kind of facing right now, but also to position ourselves for, you know, I started to say for future success, but I really mean so we can come out kicking ass and ready to really take things to a new level. And today's guest is coming back is Steve Sims. Steve has worked with some luminaries such as Sir Elton John, Elon Musk. He sent people down to see the wreck of the Titanic, and he's closed a museum in Florence for a dinner party beneath Michelangelo's David. But when Steve was on my show a little while back, we talked about his book, Blue Fishing, The Art of Making Things Happen. And what I loved about that book and love about that book is it's aimed at every single one of us. It's not about necessarily, you know, having a chance to dive down and see the Titanic or go down in a submarine. It's about making things happen in our life. And Steve, I thought it would just be such a timely occasion to bring you back, because there's a lot of people that are sitting there trying to say to themselves, I'm not sure I even want to go back to whatever normal was. And they want to make some things happen when they're coming out. So welcome back, man.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me.
All right, dude. So with that introduction, I mean, what are your first thoughts about, you know, around the topic that I just raised? Because there's a pile of people at home who are being blessed with an opportunity. It might not feel like a blessing, but they're being blessed with an opportunity to kick back and say, how happy am I with the life I've been living? And maybe this is a chance to hit a reset button.
Yeah, I don't want the past life. And I'm not trying to sit here and kind of like sound all precocious and stuff like that, but I never want to be where I was last year. I always want to be in advance of that. And here's the dumb thing. Let's get it into perspective. We've never had this opportunity in our life or anybody's ever. You see, we've had recessions, but you could still go out for dinner. We've had terrorist attacks, but you could still fly over and see your mum. We've got a situation now where we can't leave our house. As entrepreneurs, as business owners, as people, we move at 200 miles an hour. Our focus is ahead. Occasionally, we look left and right to see the scenery, but never before has the journey stopped. Never before has the train hit a pause, and we can look at our feet, we can look behind us and ask ourselves the question, is this where I wanted to be? Is my business going in the direction I want? Are my relationships going in the direction I want? Can you imagine, let's look at metaphors. You're a sailor, you're in the middle of the ocean, and all of a sudden the ocean stops. And you can go, well, okay, I've got a minute now. Let me look at my navigation tools and go, okay, am I slightly off course? Am I slightly off track? And then you can look at everything around you and go, okay, is this helping me? If it's not, clean house. The one thing I'm teaching all of my coaching clients at the moment, clean house. If it doesn't aid, assist, grow, and make you smile, or any one of those, get it out. If you have to come up for a reason to keep it, like, well, I bought that shirt 10 years ago, or, oh, I bought that CRM to do XYZ, clean it out. Get rid of this stuff. Believe it or not, we are in a phenomenal, phenomenal opportunity. And now's the time, just to finish off, now's the time for us to sharpen our tools before we go to battle. You don't want someone to say, hey, you're going to war in 10 minutes and then you're sitting on the sidelines sharpening your knife. You're going to get killed. Sharpen your weapons now, because when this is over, there is going to be a consumption circus and you want to be armed and ready to go to battle.
And, you know, history tells us that too, doesn't it? That the consumption circus always follows, you know, moments of, like, as you said, we've never had this particular moments where the journey just stopped for everybody, but we have had moments of massive, you know, economic disruption. And when everything's come out the other side, the consumption, the reality is that there are often new winners, which is the amazing things.
Yeah.
But it also means that if we're just sitting back and expecting that things are just going to come back to us, that's a very dangerous strategy.
Oh, anyone that we know that's binge watching Netflix, we should no longer know. You know, they're not the kind of people we need to be knowing. Today is the day where we get up, we do more. The second that we got the lockdown, I bought a Peloton bike, okay? Because I want to be fitter. When is a better time for me to be able to focus on my health than being stuck at home for a month? I read, we do every day, we do something called Book 40. all the family get around, which is helping me communicate with my family. We all get around on the sofas and we read a book for 40 minutes. I'm on my third book, okay? In a week, I have never read these books and I'm on my third book and I'm over the moon. I'm coming out leaner, faster, stronger and sharper. Why would you not use this opportunity to do so? You can buy all the shit you want at the end of this, but at the end of this, it's going to be amazing. It's going to be a free fall. It's going to go up. It's going to be going down. There's all these people giving predictions. Why? Because nobody knows what's going to go on.
Yeah.
But why don't you focus on the thing that you do have control of today? That's you, your asset, your head, your position, and clean house and get yourself straight.
Yeah. See, you make a great point. Like, there are all these prognosticators who are trying to predict what the world's going to look like. Well, you know, that's like, you know, like trying to pick a stock and tell you exactly what it's going to be worth a year from now, or even for a business. You and I have run businesses for a lot of years, man. But you and I both know that if we play that game of financial projections, that we're going to be wrong. Guaranteed, there is no way the number is going to be, you know, and that's why I kind of laugh. I'm going to digress a bit there, but the reality is people don't know. And I'm trying to remember who it was. It was Dr. Benjamin Hardy was on my show, and I'm not even sure.
I love him.
Yeah, I don't know whether Ben's episode will. I think this will probably come out before his, because his was a full-length discussion. But he talked so much, Steve, about the importance of visualizing your future self. So we can't visualize exactly what the world's going to look like or when or any of those kind of things, but we can visualize our future self, like what we really, truly want and what we want to look like. And I love your point about health. What my wife and I have done is use this as an opportunity to really focus on our food.
Yeah.
Say, you know what? Let's just, not with the specific purpose of losing weight or anything else, but let's make sure we're eating the best combination of foods that we can to keep ourselves strong, to feel good, to have more energy. And so no matter where you are, there's something you do that you have control about your future self, man.
So 100%.
For people that are struggling a bit, Steve, because let's also be honest, there are folks that have, especially, I've talked to millennials, and man, this is a real slap in the face for them, because they've not faced, you know, like 9/11. I remember Heather Parody was on the show the other day. Heather Parody, you know, was young enough that 9/11 was, you know, basically a walk to the ice cream shop to get an ice cream cone and to reflect on things, because she was just a child, you know. And so, but people now that are saying, you know, they've lost their income or their business revenues are drying up, how can we just help them gain the perspective that I guess it's courage, but you know, some people are really struggling to find that right now. So what words do you have?
And everyone has it. Let's be blunt. You can be all positive and gung-ho, but every now and then in the dark wee hours of the morning, that doubt creeps in. You know, there's times when you'll be doing a contract and millions are flowing around and everything's going great and you'll wake up at 1 o'clock in the morning and you're going, oh, hang on a minute, what if this happens? So everyone gets that. And I call it the pity party. There's those moments in your life where you just go, oh God, you know, how am I going to get over this? What you've got to do is you've got to get yourself on a 30,000 foot view. You've got to be able to look down and go, okay, all right. It's all right to feel a bit doubtful. It's all right to have my courage knocked. But there's a difference between having it knocked and then refusing to go back in the fight. Now, at this moment, if you ask anybody in the planet, summer of 2021, do you think we'll still have coronavirus or do you think we'll be back to normal? And everyone you speak to will go, oh God, it'll be gone by then. It'll be gone by then. All right. So we don't know if it's going to be gone summer, but we know a year from now it's 100% gone. And so if we scale back, do you think it's going to be here by Christmas? Oh no, you know, it should be gone by. The bottom line of it is, if you know this is not going to last forever, why don't you use that moment to go, okay, now let's look internally. You know, if someone said to you, and I had this with a podcast mirror yesterday, I said to him, if someone said to you, you were on a lockdown for 2 months, okay? You may well be. You were on a lockdown for 2 months. If I said to you, what would you do in 2 months? And he said, well, I've got this guitar and I've always wanted to learn this tune. And I said, why aren't you doing it? Why don't you pick it up today and try that riff badly? And then try it again the following day and the following day. In 2 months' time, you're going to be a master of that. Think of all the books you could have read. Think of all the languages you could learn. Think of all the recipes you could have learned. think of the connection that you can have with your people in your house. You see, I've never had the time to be spending 24 hours with my kids, with my wife. And I'll be honest with you, we are having a great time because we've gone through doubt. You have the moments of, oh my God, what are we going to do about the money? But let's be blunt, the biggest liability you got is your mortgage, and they've all been postponed. Yeah. Okay. My daughter's renting an apartment that's been postponed. So you haven't got that on your head. It's not like the recession where they still want their money at the end of the month. Yeah. This has been kited off. Okay. Great. No longer to worry about it. Worry on yourself and what can make you better. And where have you lost the way? Let's be blunt. We work so hard. We buy CRM programs. We eat badly. We drink too much. Now we've had a pause. We can look back and go, did that do me any good? You know, in the old analogy story, you know, did it make the boat go faster? And the bottom line of it is 9 times out of 10, no, you got caught up. So now's the chance for me to turn around and go, well, did that new car really do anything for me? You know, did that holiday really help me? You know, and the answer may be yes, and it'll still be there. We're not going to go back into the same world. Hurrah. Why? Because the biggest thing that we've had removed from us is not our income, is not our dependency on getting out there whenever we want to. It's the fact that we've lost the ability to hug, communicate, and connect with another person. And they say about this social distancing, this started 15 years ago with something called Friendster and MySpace. And we've been self-distancing since then.
Yeah.
They say you lust for something once you lose it. We've lost the ability to have proper human interaction. I guarantee you when this is over, everyone's going to be having a conversation in a coffee shop. Everyone's going to be having... My concern is that we forget too fast. And I'm hoping we don't, because we've had it removed, the ability to communicate with other people. And now we need to be focusing on how do we do it. We can do it now with FaceTime, WhatsApp, you know, Zoom, all these other programs. But when we're given the chance to get out the gates, when the lights are back on, when the masks are off, hug someone you care about. Have a conversation with a stranger. Be nicer. Because for 2 months, we never had the ability to do that. Remember it.
You know, the other thing that I'd like your thoughts on, Stephen, I've said this to a few people, but, you know, the point about hugging someone you care about, spot on, it's so important. But I also think a lot of people have forgotten how to love themselves. And the reason I know that is because people are struggling so much with this isolation, which at sometimes inevitably means you're going to have more time with yourself just to think about things. And, you know, like I'm a kind of guy, if I don't get alone time, people don't want to be around me. And I've always carved that space out, but I'm seeing so many people that are just visibly uncomfortable doing it. And we've got to get them to take the time to, you know, love yourself and to embrace your faults and, you know, forget about the past and or other people's expectations on what you were supposed to be. I'll get rid of all this crap, because like you say, you don't normally get 2 months to just sit there and think about that stuff.
Often the scariest thing to look at is yourself.
Yeah.
But it's also the thing that drives absolutely everything. Your decisions, your business, your relationships. You know, if you're driving around in a car that's got a really bad engine, you know it ain't going to last long. Well, nor are you. And again, we have the opportunity. That's why I said, I speak on stages. I'm on a plane. Here's an actual fact. Last October, I started doing a bunch of speaking gigs. Just as they stopped the shops and the stores and everything, and there was the clampdown March. That was the first time I had been home for 5 days straight since October. I had come home, got a new suitcase, got on a plane somewhere, and I was literally all over the planet. And of course, wasn't working out, wasn't eating straight, wasn't, you know, looking after myself. I was drinking, I was eating steak, you know, all the time. Now I've been able to look around and go, did that do me any good? Far from it. I've now got baggage I need to get. I've slowed up on the drinking. I'm eating better. You got to focus on yourself. And it's hard. And it's very hard to every now and then look at yourself, especially like you, if you're in the public eye. You know, because people look at you and they go, oh, yeah, you got your shit together. We need to get our shit together. We need to, like you just said, you need that alone time. I've learned from this, I have to keep working out. My mind is better. I react better. I'm more positive. I don't want to lose that. So I am building up habits now to make me better. But you've got to love yourself, because if you don't love yourself, how can you love anything else?
Yeah, and you can't help anybody else. And, you know, like you, man, one of the things that I've learned, and I think I probably, you know, subconsciously have known this for a long time, but I basically stopped drinking red, you know, drinking, period. Like, for now, anyway, so for about 4 or 5 weeks now. And it's simply because I love a good glass of red wine. And, but I realized that I'd fallen into the habit after a really good day. Like, I spend most of my days having conversations like this. They're uplifting and energizing. But then you do, at the end of that day, sort of have that come down period. And instead of just going up and spending some time with my wife or reading a book I've been wanting to read or whatever, I get out, the glass of wine. And I'm not saying I love red wine. I know I'm going back to it. But I just said, you know what? For now, I'm just going to put it aside. Maybe save it for that celebratory moment when things, you know, when I can start to get out and maybe be in person to person with somebody other than my wife. And, hey, this is a really nice bottle. Now let's share it together, you know, to get back to that stuff. I mean, everybody can find something, you know.
We did a thing, because I like to have a whiskey cocktail at the weekend. I don't do it every night. I have this funny image where I'm drinking all the time. That's far from it. I have like two cocktails every weekend kind of thing, and I'm good. But the other Friday, I actually said something. I said, hey, because I have a Facebook group, an Entrepreneur's Advantage with Steve Sims. And I said, look, why don't you come and have a virtual happy hour with me, and I'll show you how to make an old fashioned, because my standing joke is I'm stunned at how many bartenders can't actually make this drink. We had about 70 people come through that virtual happy hour that just told jokes, interacted, laughed at each other. And I realized there were 70 people on a Friday night at 5 o'clock gagging to do this. It was so successful. A lot of them have spurred it on to actually do it within their own groups. We've got another one this Friday. It's what people are after. People are lusting for it. And I spoke to a girl in the happy hour, and she said that she'd been separated from her husband because he was somewhere else before the clampdown. And she hasn't seen him for 15 days. And she said the chance to be able to get on the Zoom call and just have a giggle with people.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I mean, and you're making a point. I think it was Zach Friedman was on a couple of days ago, but Zach made a great point. We are through all this, seeing examples like you're talking about of humanity, and we're seeing goodness come out of people, and we're also it's very easy to identify the ones where the goodness is not coming out, I wonder, because I think we're going to remember little acts of kindness. I sent a message to a friend today. I won't call him out on air, but, you know, because his wife has been posting some very thought-provoking things on Facebook, you know, encouraging tolerance and understanding of people that have mental wellness challenges and that had it going into this situation. And the example she gave was, like, you know, up here, like, we're asked to limit our, you know, what they call social driving, because most things are closed. But, you know, like a hardware store is still open. So, you know, somebody went out and bought a gallon of paint. And neighbors were phoning and complaining about it and posting all over the internet and everything. And she just said, did it ever occur to you that maybe this is a person that struggles with anxiety and knows that if they don't find a way to keep busy and to do something, that it's going to have a really big consequence on them and their family and everything else? And, you know, but I sent him a little note privately. I just said, you know what, you already know this, but you picked a hell of a good partner there. And just tiny little things like that, I guarantee this person's going to remember that for, you know, for some time. And it took me
while. Yeah, you're right.
60 seconds of my time, but it popped into my head to do it. We can all do stuff like that every day.
Yep, 100%. And we need to. We almost need to think, you know, I did a post a little while ago. The successful people are the ones that wake up and ask, okay, where's my opportunity today? Our opportunity today is to strengthen connections. So you should look through your calendar. Let's be honest, you're not driving to work. You're sick of Netflix, so what else have you got to do? Look through your contact list and go, do you know, I haven't spoken to Bobby for 4 years. I haven't spoken to Mildred. I haven't spoken to Molly. You know, I haven't phoned up my mum every day. Get them on FaceTime. Get them on WhatsApp video. Get them on Zoom. Get them on Skype. Get the face going, okay? Yeah. Not just a phone call. If all you can do is the phone call, fine. If all you can do is record a message, and text it to the person, do it. But go for gold. Go for face-to-face interaction. Get on any of these face apps that we can and communicate and go, hey, I got 10 minutes on my hand. Let's make a cup of tea and let's just sit down and natter. You know, what you got going on? You know, how's the roses? You know, are you enjoying this? Are you reading any good books? Have you seen any good show? Just natter with people.
Yeah. No, I agree with you. Full disclosure here, our son lives in Halifax, about a 3-hour drive from here. And in a typical year, we're probably, other than around holidays, we're face-to-face with him maybe 3 or 4 more other times in a year, you know. And we decided to go a bit more this year. But the other times, almost all the communication is in Messenger. You know, going back, last night, at his suggestion, we got the whole family together, you know, like my daughter and her husband and Jonathan and her, his girlfriend, and Debbie and I, each of us on our phones, on, you know, Messenger face, you know, but a video call, and just chatted. I'm thinking, why the hell weren't we doing this before? But it's like to say 200 miles an hour, I got to do this, I got to do that, everybody's busy, you know, we'll have to book a time in our calendars to do this kind of stuff. And now I'm hopeful that, like you say, I think before I give you the last word, real gold when you said, I hope we don't forget too soon, you know, the lessons we're learning here, because there's some real gold in what we've been given the opportunity. Or Steve, you know, just before we wrap and I ask you where people can find you and stuff, any last words for folks to, you know, help them out these days?
Yeah, bottom line of it is, if you think you're screwed and everything's going to go to pot and it's the end of the world, then you're right. It's 100% a mindset at the moment. I do honestly believe, and we all flapped a bit when the whole thing came in of this coronavirus. We all looked at it and went, oh my God. Yeah. But there's that moment to kind of like reel back, and then there's that moment to put the gloves on and step forward. And we're being presented with a phenomenal opportunity. When this is over, you're going to find people who are studying languages, music, art, so many things. And you're going to kick yourself in the tush and go, I wasted that. Yeah. I was trying to get through bloody Amazon Prime and Netflix. I wasted that moment. Don't be one of those people. Start what you want to do in the next 20 to 30 minutes from listening to this podcast.
Yeah. Steve, I'm going to give you an opportunity to give one a shout out to your book, because I think it's really a timely one right now. And also just let people know if they want to, you know, follow you, catch up with you, learn more from you, you know, tell us where they can get you and all that stuff.
Well, I've got a free Facebook page called An Entrepreneur's Advantage with Steve Sims. You can find me at stevedsims.com, the website, only one M. And thanks for promoting the book, Bluefish in the Art of Making Things Happen. It actually got released in Poland about 6 weeks ago, just before this clampdown, and sold out in day one. So we're literally all over Asia. They're actually and I would imagine it's been postponed now, but they were just about to release it in Russia. So I'm still in awe of how much of an impact it has actually made. And the good thing is, with it being based around so much on communication and connection and the ROI of relationships, I can see it being more valuable as we go through the next 10 years.
Yeah, no, I agree. It's timeless and timely. Steve, thanks for being with me, man.
Look after yourself, pal. Thanks for having me.
All right.